We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome to LA Progressive Live, where we delve deep into issues of social justice and progressive politics. This is your host, Sharon Kyle, in studio, as always, with my husband and co-host, Dick Price.
How you doing, Sugar? Promises to be an exciting show with our friend from the ACLU. We're going to talk at length about immigrant rights issues, but I know that you wanted to talk about two of your dear friends who passed away recently.
Yes. I hardly ever talk about this, but for most of my adult life, before we got engaged in social activism and started the LA Progressive, I worked for NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory. And my job at JPL was to support spaceflight projects by ensuring that there was adequate funding and adequate resources to conduct the missions. Two women who I became friends with there, one whose name is Claudia Alexander, I actually just learned today that Claudia Alexander passed away. Claudia was, at the time of her passing, the project manager for the Rosetta Project. The Rosetta Project is a project that was studying a comet, and I can't even pronounce the name of the project, the comet. But Claudia was definitely a trailblazer. During my tenure at NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory, Claudia was the only black female project manager in the 23 years I was there, and perhaps ever. Claudia was also a scientist. She was the project scientist. And she was, in addition to the work that she did at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, she wrote children's books.
Oh, how interesting.
Yes. And Claudia and I had actually collaborated a bit and talked about how the LA Progressive might feature some of her writings for children's books.
Oh.
So she wrote children's books. She was a scientist, a NASA scientist, an award-winning project manager, and she was also way into sports, particularly tennis.
So was the Rosetta Project one of those NASA projects where they try to land a space vehicle on the comet itself, get samples, and return them?
No. It was not a sample return mission.
Oh.
No, it was not a sample return mission, and actually we had very few of those. But it was a European-led mission. It was a mission where NASA, America's space agency, collaborated with the European Space Agency to do a study of a comet. A similar mission was Stardust, which I worked on Stardust, where we studied samples of material from a comet. And then the other person who passed away, who was also really a dear friend, is Pearline Johnson. And Pearline Johnson and I had similar roles at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, except that what I did for the Mars Pathfinder mission, for the Genesis mission, for the Stardust mission, for the Magellan mission, and a couple of others. And she worked with Galileo and Ulysses. And she basically did the same thing that I did, which was ensure that there was sufficient funding in-house so that the missions could adequately pay for the staff and the scientists and the engineers and the business people, that we were able to do procurements. And Pearline Johnson worked for the Jet Propulsion Laboratory for 40 years,
wow,
her entire adult life. At the time that I was there, most people who worked at JPL, they didn't leave. I mean, in many respects, it was a very unique place. It was a fabulous place to be most of the time. And some of my longest and deepest friendships are there at JPL.
Yeah, I know when we met and started dating 13 years ago, you were working at JPL, and it sounded like a really fascinating and thrilling life. You were on the actual mission
Genesis
teams, but you'd been on a series of mission teams. where you would support projects that would launch vehicles someplace to Mars or out to test a comet.
That's right. Some launched vehicles. In the case of the Genesis project, which is the project that I was supporting at the time that you and I met, that mission was a mission to capture solar ions.
Right.
So we had launched a space a space object, and it was about 1 million miles away from Earth, located 1 million miles between Earth and the Sun, and captured solar ions, and that was, in fact, a sample return mission.
Right.
So the mission did come back to Earth. The spacecraft
did
come back to Earth, and it came back in a big way.
So you took me out to Dugway Proving Grounds, and we watched with some considerable excitement with all the people on the project. And the idea was the capsule was supposed to come down, and a parachute was going to open, and it was going to float down to...
Well, it wasn't going to float down. We had
a helicopter was going to catch it
with
mid-air.
An arm that was supposed to grab the parachute and then gently rest it on the desert floor out there at the proving grounds in Utah.
But one engineer had the wise idea to put the cap on backwards, so the parachute never deployed.
Well, I won't comment on that. So,
but I did want to honor
my two friends,
yeah.
Perlene Johnson and
right.
Claudia Alexander, who were both trailblazing women, the few. I mean, there really were very few of us women there, and certainly much fewer black women.
Right.
And it was just a great loss to NASA for both of these women. By the way, Perlene had retired about 3 years ago.
Yeah.
But
I'm sorry to hear your news.
Yeah, me too. So we wanted to talk a little bit about Bernie.
Yeah, we wanted to talk about Bernie Sanders in this sense, that we know between now and November of next year, there's going to be an endless horse race. And because we have our nose in the news so much, sometimes we get put off by the, you know, Walker's ahead of Christie and Trump's ahead of somebody and Bernie's this and Hillary's that. And what gets missing in this horse race commentary oftentimes is a real focus on the particular issues. And Bernie Sanders is a fascinating counterexample, because he has been, you know, an activist since the 60s and has long held positions that don't change with the wind. They may evolve as history evolves, but he has real things that you can sink your teeth in and know that he really means it.
Yes, right.
Go ahead. Well, and one example. I mean, so what we wanted to do is spend a few minutes at this show and maybe other shows coming up, talking about the actual issues that may go on in this presidential race and other races, not the fact that Hillary's got 53% of the latest poll and Bernie's got 32, but rather, for example, that Bernie Sanders has this idea that anybody who's up to going to college ought to go at least the first 2 years for free. And this is an issue that you and I have talked about. Now, we just helped my daughter graduate from UC Riverside, and because I had the foresight to get wounded a couple times in Vietnam, she went tuition free.
Not a bad plan.
Right. It worked out
but
pretty well.
But
as we know, you know, tuition now, the cost now for a four-year college at a private college like your daughter went to is $250,000. At a public school like our guest went to or my daughter went to, it can run for 4 years $150,000. Now, sure, there are scholarships and there's scholarships and loans and so forth, but that sticker tag is scaring a lot of people away from school. Now, in my case, I went to school 1 million years ago in the 60s, and I could go to a private school for $1,000 a semester. $2,000 a year, and then I graduated from a public college where I could support myself with a $40 disability check, a $200 GI Bill, and a job running a residence hall for students, and then be a real cheapskate, and I didn't have to do more than that. And the result of that is the guys, the men and women, the boys and girls that went to my kind of working class high school in the suburbs of Minneapolis Lots and lots of them could go to college. Lots of them did. Nowadays, as you remember, in helping my daughter prepare for school, a lot of her students from a working class or middle class neighborhood in the suburbs of LA weren't even thinking about it.
Right. So I don't think that we really need to belabor all the details as to why it's so an education is so important. I think what I'd like to say about Bernie Sanders is he says what other candidates avoid saying. For example, and this is a quote directly from Bernie Sanders. He says, "Wall Street banks and large companies love America when they need corporate welfare. But when it comes to paying taxes, they want nothing to do with this country."
Right.
Could you ever imagine Hillary Clinton saying something like that?
Well, see, that's what we're going to find in this horse race. Lots of people are going to say lots of things. But the difference with Bernie Sanders is he's got 40, 50 years of examples.
Saying the same thing.
Doing the same thing. Before the show started, I asked you what SNCC stood for. I forgot. It was
Student Nonviolent
Coordinating Committee. Because Bernie has been criticized that he hasn't taken strong issues on racism and on the police shootings. And his rejoinder is, well, in the 60s, he was an organizer for SNCC. He was one of the two senators who attended Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream speech back in the 60s. The other one happened to be your friend Mitch McConnell.
That's a really good point,
right?
That Mitch McConnell was there. Being there at a protest march is, in my opinion, it's good, but it's simply not enough. In favor of Bernie, I will say that for 40 years, he has taken the same position on all these matters. And I want to get back to him talking about the banks and talking about corporations.
Okay.
And I brought Hillary in specifically because many of these same corporations, the financiers who are funding her campaign, are not funding Bernie's campaign. And the reason they're not funding Bernie's campaign is because he is so critical of them. And he's so critical of this business of the deep pockets, the corporate interests owning the United States. He's talked on many occasions about how we need to change campaign finance. We need campaign finance reform. And he is saying it and calling names. And that's very unusual.
Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. I would say to tie into what I was talking about education, part of the reason that education costs have gone up so high, particularly at private schools, is the 1% wants to reserve the best spots for their 1% kids.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, so we've kind of eaten up our time talking about Bernie, but that's not the end of it. We're going to be talking about Bernie quite a bit over the coming months. We think he's an interesting candidate, and we want this show to differ from others. We're not just going to talk about his electability. We're not going to talk about election strategy. We're going to talk about the issues.
That's why I of the two of us, did not bring his opponent's name up.
Oh, you should have told me that. I didn't know that was the plan. Okay,
all right.
So this is LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from latalklive.com. We're going to be taking a brief break, but when we return, we will be interviewing our guest, Joanna Amador. Stick around.
No time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
That's really good.
Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. I go to the movie, and I go down.
Welcome back to LA Progressive Live. This is Sharon Kyle in studio with my husband and co-host Dick Price. And before we went to the break, we were mentioning that we have a guest here. Why don't you tell us about our guest, Dick?
Right. So welcome, Joanna. Joanna Amador serves with us on our Pasadena Foothills ACLU chapter. She's the vice president who's going to be taking over for me. She has heavily involved in immigrant rights since she was a child, I gather, and that really that's what the show is going to be about. So you have you principally with past guest Miguel Paredes and some others are planning an event for Thursday morning about DACA under attack. Can you tell me what's going on Thursday morning?
And tell us, tell us what DACA is.
Right.
The Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals is being contested by the state of Arizona, and it is being heard in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals this Thursday, July 16th at, I believe, 10 a.m. But we are gathering together at 9:30 a.m. in the morning for a press conference. And this is where a lot of our partner organizations like CHIRLA and the California Dream Network and the ACLU and other immigrant rights partners are going to be showing up and showing their support for this program that benefits the youth who were brought here before they were 16 years old. Arrived undocumented, and this is the only place that they know of as home. And this is a program that protects them from being essentially deported.
So this is being challenged in the courts, and for reasons that I don't even know if we have time to go in, but this has been a highly charged debate. We have had immigration in this country since its inception. It's nothing new, but in my memory, I don't remember immigration being such a hotly charged issue. It's just really been just the past 15 or so years that it's been as hotly charged as it is. And the president, President Obama, has taken steps with DAPA and DACA, but also, unfortunately, has been the president that has deported more people than any president in history, perhaps all presidents combined.
Yeah, and that's true. And that's a lot of the conversations that a lot of the immigrant rights groups discuss and would really want the president's support in stopping all deportations, you know, having a moratorium on deportations. But that's not happening.
So DACA, is this the one that's the presidential initiative where he is the president issued an executive order that is DACA?
Yes. So this was the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, the case that's being argued in a couple of days, is the first part of the program, not the expanded program that was announced last year in November, but the older DACA program that was announced in 2012. Uh-huh. And so this had the age limitation up to 30 years old. The new DACA program extends, actually broadens the group of people that can apply. And the type of protections, and also it allows for a longer protection. Currently, the 2012 program that still takes on applications for this protection allows a two-year protection and employment authorization. With the new expanded program, it allows for 3 years of deferred status from deportation or prosecutorial discretion from not being deported, and it also allows for a three-year employment authorization to stay in the United States without the limitation of being capped at 30 years old, and it also broadens the time frame of when the person that's applying had to be present consistently during a specific time frame.
Right. So when my children were in high school, one of my son's best friends when they graduated from high school, and all the kids were applying to college, one of my son's best friends discovered that he was undocumented. He never knew he was undocumented. Yeah. In fact, he thought he was born in the United States. He came to this country as a baby. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until they were applying for college and applying for grants, you know, federal grants and so and such, that he found out that not only could he not apply, but that he was at risk of being deported to a country that he had never been to, that he remembered. Mm-hmm. Aside from being born there, he was brought here as a baby. He had no memory of ever being in that country.
And that's a conversation that I would say most youth that benefited from the program could tell you, that they have very, very vague memories of, you know, their homeland, that they don't really necessarily speak the language. And so they, you know, it's really foreign to them going back to some of these places that they do have a connection to, but it's not as strong as here, the United States, where they've grown up, where they've, you know, gone to school, where they have all their relationships and their friends, their school, you know, all that makes their identity here.
Yeah, and we do have a friend, Unai Montes Iroeste, who was actually deported. He was born here in the U.S., but it, since his parents were here illegally, he was deported, where he was an American in his own eyes and not really familiar with Mexico, hadn't lived there before, mm-hmm. and got a rough ride.
Yeah, and I mean, I think you personally, I mean, I have similar experiences with family members who were deported, and their children have to live in Mexico, and they're really angry. They're angry that they have to go to their parents' home country, to Mexico, for in my case, and they, you know, lose that connection with, you know, the United States. They don't like the president. They're unhappy that their mom has to be there for 10 right. years, and you know, it's just, it's that kind of relationship where when and if they ever want to come back to the United States, they're going to have a very, I would say, maybe unfriendly idea of what America stands for.
So I have a question. I find it interesting that whenever we have these discussions about the unfairness of our immigration policy, we hardly ever tie it into our trade policies.
Yeah, that.
And that, to me, I mean, if you really want to look at starting ground, where did these issues start? It start with our trade policies.
Yeah, trade and our economic needs here in the United States. What's cheap labor? You know, you have the cheap labor coming in for some of the jobs that nobody wants to take on, that really people don't like to talk about. And you have a lot of the economic push and pull factors, you know, from different countries, from certainly what you would classify as third world countries, coming in to the United States and serving that need that major corporations need, that our agriculture needs to function.
Right, right. I mean, I don't think people understand that most immigrants, legal or illegal, don't come in here necessarily because they like the climate. They come here because people pulled them here, corporations pulled them here to work in the fields, work in the meat packing plants. We wanted them here. That's why we have 11 million people without documents. Or, and then on the other hand, we have NAFTA, our wonderful trade program, that utterly destroyed the corn production in Mexico, replaced it with our factory farm produced corn from the Midwest, put all those Mexican farmers out of work, and what are they going to do? Starve or go find a job in the U.S.?
Yeah.
Fortunately, you know, we were talking about Bernie Sanders. He has said that he favors a pathway to citizenship for the 11 million undocumented immigrants.
Which is good.
But in the news, how much did you guys pay Donald Trump to make this such a central issue so early?
Yeah, he's not. Oh, he's definitely a character. We didn't pay him anything. He's actually, you know, I can't say anything awful about people in general, but God, he is one character that most Mexicans and Mexican Americans and overall Latinos are really disgusted by what he said. And personally took offense to it, especially when, you know, you think of your parents and your aunts and your uncles and your grandparents who came here and have struggled to, you know, really provide a good living for their family, both here that they bring over, that they create here in the United States, but also that they send, you know, remittances home, money so that they can, you know, survive. And it's pretty distasteful. It's disgusting. It's hateful. It brings in a lot of the old rhetoric about, you know, get out of here. You don't belong. And you have a lot of the old groups of people saying, well, you know, go back where you came from.
Right. So not only that, but it's just patently false.
Yes.
And he should know better. So recently, there was a report issued by the American Immigration Council, and the report is called The Criminalization of Immigration in the United States. And what they found is that immigrants are less likely to commit serious crimes or be behind bars than native-borns. Mm-hmm. And high rates of immigration are associated with lower rates of violent crime and lower rates of property crime. So it's exactly the opposite of what he's saying. Now, either he knows it and he's intentionally misleading people, trying to say something provocative that's going to get his name in headlines, which it did, or he just doesn't care.
Well, I mean, you know, he probably knows that what he's saying is a load of horseshit, but you know, there's a history of running against immigrants.
Yeah.
Pete Wilson, from several decades ago, was governor of California, running heavily against immigrants. Whatever he truly felt, it got him into office. And I don't think Donald Trump stands a bad chance. I don't think he really wants to be president. He just wants the spotlight. But on the other hand, you know, immigrant rights groups must be at least a little happy that he's driving up participation in those groups.
Well, it definitely makes for our life a little bit easier as far as in getting people activated and motivated to get involved, get organized, and hopefully register to vote and get out when it matters. So it is doing that. It is lighting a fire under people's butts, as we would say, to really get organized if we really want to elect a person who will do justice by the immigrant community, who's been really supportive of a lot of different candidates, in particular the Democrats.
So let's get back to DACA, because we're going to be taking a break in a couple of minutes. Mm-hmm. And when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about DAPA and also AB 60. But before we conclude our discussion with DACA, what do you think is going to happen with the extension? So right now, the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals is reviewing just the basic DACA's being challenged.
Yes.
So what about the extension?
Well, and I think that's the other case that was just heard on Friday in the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals, and that's
in the Fifth Circuit, not the Ninth Circuit?
No, the Fifth Circuit. So in last Friday, the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals took on the challenging both DACA and DAPA, and the interesting thing is that you have conservative judges and one progressive or liberal judge hearing this case, and there's a temporary restraining order, not an injunction. Yes, an injunction, and that injunction is deterring the really the government from accepting any applications for parents and for the expanded DACA program. And so they had an oral argument. I think in the future we will likely see this going to the Supreme Court, depending on this case and the one that is about to be heard on Thursday. I think that both both of those cases might get combined and sent to the Supreme Court, because a lot of the issues stem from constitutional law, preemption issues, what law is the supreme law of the land, and who has certain rights.
Yeah, isn't it basically whether the president has the right to issue these executive orders?
Well, you know, I'm not too familiar on the exact claims by the state of Texas, but I know that for the one on Thursday, they are making certainly some of those claims.
Okay, so we're going to be taking a brief break, and when we return, we'll be talking a little bit more about DAPA, which is different from DACA. Joanna is going to explain those differences to us. This is LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from latalklive.com. Stick around. We'll be back in a bit.
Of slave drive and sweat and wealth's on my back. This is my country. Doo-hoo-hoo.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
It started out like a totally normal day.
I love you.
I mean, I guess I was a little sweaty, and I was definitely sore. I thought I had gas. Turns out, I was having a heart attack. Heart disease is the number one killer of American women. So now I take care of myself and tell the other women in my life to do the same. Make it your mission to save your life and the lives of the women you love. Find out more from the American Heart Association at goredforwomen.org.
Do you or does someone you know have sickle cell disease? Have you heard about the EPIC study? It's an international research study evaluating an investigational drug aimed at shortening the duration of painful crisis. And with over 50 sites in the U.S., there may be a site near you. To learn more and to find out if the EPIC study is right for you, visit www.theepicstudy.com. This program is provided with funding from Mass Therapeutics, sponsors of the EPIC study, a clinical trial for sickle cell disease. For more information, please visit www.theepicstudy.com.
NOMA, the National Organization of Minority Architects Youth Summer Camp, consists of field trips to iconic architectural complexes. Join us for 3 days of hands-on building design learning experiences. To register, go to SoCalNOMA.org. That's SoCalNOMA.org.
Welcome back to LA Progressive Live. This is Sharon Kyle in studio with my co-host and husband, Dick Price. And Dick, we were just talking to Joanna Amador, who is our guest, and why don't you pick up that conversation?
Right. Well, so we've worked with you for several years on the ACLU and know you and gotten to know you. But your interest in immigrant rights is not newfound. I mean, I understand you've been involved since you were a kid. Can you tell us how you got involved?
Well, sure. I guess the very first memories that I have of really knowing that I was somewhat different was that my parents had to go and apply for status in the 80s through amnesty. And so through that, I, you know, really became aware that there was something wrong. Then during the 90s, you know, Prop 187 certainly was the very first time that I saw my parents and family members get organized and protest and participate civically in these type of activities. And that's how my mom and actually my dad both applied for citizenship. My mom was the only one that actually followed through and became a naturalized citizen. And since then, I've been involved on a different level, more on employment rights issues, working with migrant farm workers, But more and more recently, just getting involved in this, the conversation about making sure that immigrants are overall protected and that we get some comprehensive immigration reform to take care of all these immigrants that contribute to our society. So I've been involved off and on, I would say most of my life, but really in seeking immigration reform and supporting that effort more recently, within maybe the past 3 years.
So you were saying earlier, but while we were on break, that your involvement years ago was more concentrated on labor issues. So mm-hmm. for people that, let's say they're, you know, they're people that have no connections at all to issues of immigration reform, could you talk to them about some of the kinds of exploitation that led you to be involved in the labor movement as it relates to immigration?
Sure. You know, I was an intern for an organization in Chicago, and we would go to farm camps in Illinois, throughout Illinois. And through my involvement, I saw the really terrible conditions that they were living under, especially those that were coming under the visa program, the way that they were kept isolated. You know, you could almost call them indentured servants. Mm. The level of, you know, isolation, and also the type of living that they lived under wouldn't be what you and I call comfortable. Certainly, I would say that the state agencies visited those places and said, well, you know, it's fine for living quarters, but it wouldn't be a place that they would probably live in, and right. certainly wouldn't be a place that I would feel comfortable living in. And it was very interesting because we would go to these camps and give them information on what their rights were, you know, if they got injured, if they had any concerns, if they had children, you know, to enroll them in school, to make sure that they were, you know, catching up their children in their academics, because a lot of these you know, farm workers move from place to place, and so they bring their families, and sometimes they leave during, you know, shorter school periods.
So mid-semester.
Mid-semester. They go from one state to the next to pick the different type of fruit that's in season, or vegetable, or what have you. And certainly I was involved. I started to see that the injustices there, and just employment-related issues, from, you know, people getting injured to, you know, people not getting compensated for the work as per their agreement.
Right.
And so, you know, we took a lot of those cases to the attorney that was supervising us, and thankfully got them, you know, their either assistance, medical care, or, you know, their money that was owed to them.
So one of the components of the Fight for 15 here in Los Angeles, where there are organizers fighting to raise the minimum wage. Well, one of the elements of that fight is to ensure that people actually get paid. There's a lot of wage theft.
Yeah, and I think there's a lot of wage theft too, because people that work, that really need that money, much rather get some money versus none. And so you will see a lot of people that are afraid to speak out. But there are a lot of helpful clinics. For instance, I volunteered with the Neighborhood Legal Services for a couple of years after coming back to California from Illinois. And we really help, you know, anyone that was coming in with issues of either not getting compensated at all, or getting compensated but not getting their overtime, and, you know, their meal and rest breaks and stuff like that. And so there are a lot of different nonprofits that provide those services that people should consider going to and getting support services from them.
So I mentioned earlier that you have a Juris Doctorate, a law school degree, and I believe you have plans to work in this realm going forward.
Yes, at some point I would definitely like to work in my field. I see myself working in immigrant rights, just because it's so important to me, and it's so personal, and I get a lot of gratification from helping and from seeing people succeed, similar to what my parents' story. And I would also like to work in labor law related issues, so really just helping people.
So let's talk a little bit about DAPA. So mm-hmm. before we went to our break, we were talking about DACA, which is the deferred action for children and
childhood arrivals.
Childhood arrivals. Yes. And DAPA.
Yeah, which is a deferred action of parents of American citizens and lawful permanent resident children. And so that was announced by President Obama with the extended DACA program that we talked about a little bit earlier in 2014, and this would provide protection to about 4.9 million people. Wow. That are currently in the United States. Wow. Without lawful presence, that are undocumented, and they would really benefit from this. And some of the requirements are that they have to have lived in the United States from January 1st 2010, and that they're not an enforcement priority for removal for the United States, and they have like a list of different priority removals, but certainly those that pose a threat to security, public health, and public safety, border security, those who have committed misdemeanors, more than three serious misdemeanors, domestic violence, sexual assault, a lot of different, there's just a list of different categories that prevent a person from applying when qualifying once this actually gets approved and ready to go.
So along those lines, we're working with you, or you're leading an effort for a second form at the end of the month that's yes. going to address both DACA and DAPA. Do you want to talk a little bit about that event as well?
Sure. So our chapter with
our chapter of the
ACLU and CHIDLA, as well as All Saints and other immigrant rights groups, are going to be having a forum on the 29th of July at Villa Park in Pasadena to talk about these two cases and what we can do to, one, to prepare for and in case, and hopefully when this all gets decided and we get to move forward with these programs. And also what we can do in the meantime to make sure that our voices are heard. And I know that CHIDLA has an initiative to get people to register to vote, and also to get, you know, a lawful permanent residents who qualify to become naturalized citizens to take that plunge and become a citizen to be able to vote.
So for people who are unfamiliar with CHIDLA, you want to talk about what is CHIDLA and how would they find out more?
Sure.
About CHIDLA?
So CHIDLA is a coalition for humane immigrant rights of Los Angeles, and they are a nonprofit group that help immigrants in LA, but really they've expanded to go statewide. So they will be providing services statewide soon. I don't work for them, but I know I've heard Miguel say that they're going statewide, so that's great. But they provide a lot of preparation for our immigrant community here with educational forums. They also have people that help with applications for instance, for the DACA. I know that personally, one of someone that I know, youth, went to them directly to have them look at their application
Which
for renewal.
Right. So this is a good point for both DACA and DAPA, and for the next thing that we're going to be talking about, AB 60. Mm-hmm. This isn't simply sort of the president just waving a magic wand, and people that meet this criteria suddenly now are protected and deferred. They have to actually
Apply. Yeah, they have to apply. They have to pay a fee. They have to make sure that they, you know, they qualify under those guidelines and they aren't prevented by, you know, a lot of these priority people that they want to get out of the country or remove from the country. So, you know, they have to qualify for it. They have to apply. It just doesn't happen by magic.
Right. And is the application process daunting? Is there a lot of paperwork?
You know, it looks daunting if you're not familiar with, you know, the legal system. But that's why it's so helpful and so great to have these immigrant rights organizations that provide these services and guide people who are unfamiliar.
So does CLU charge people?
You know, I believe that they do. They have a membership fee of about maybe $35. And I'm not sure if that's a yearly membership mm-hmm. or if it's a monthly membership. But they do charge for a certain service.
So a part of the issue is that people whose papers aren't in order are here undocumented. I mean, they live their lives avoiding authorities, mm-hmm. avoiding paperwork, avoiding getting known to the authorities. So a big part of the struggle is to reach out to people and say, here are these plans that, you know. But there's also a risk because DAPA and DACA are done by presidential executive order.
Yeah.
And one day, in the not too distant future, we're going to have a different president.
Yes, and that's definitely a lot of the concerns that went behind people deciding whether or not to apply for DACA. Initially, those were the concerns. Oh, well, now they have my information. That means right. that they'll find me. They right. know that maybe, you know, you have a blended type of family where, you know, not everyone in your household is documented. So, well, they know where you're at. So right. what precludes them from going to your house and, you know, taking whoever else doesn't have documentation?
And there really are no assurances.
There aren't.
The only thing that might provide some sense of security is if people register to vote and vote for the president that is likely to continue to support this.
Yes.
But, you know, that's a real damage. I mean, we can sit here and laugh at Donald Trump. I mean, he is pretty ridiculous. But what he does raise, and then he generates support.
Yeah.
I mean, he was here in L.A. speaking to a bunch of conservative Hollywood types. And around the country, he draws a crowd. So what he does is he identifies that there's a thread in American political life that is anti-immigrant.
Yeah.
Let's
be clear here. They're not anti-immigrant. They're anti-brown immigrant. They're anti-Latino immigrant. You don't hear them talking about Canadians or people that are coming in from Asia or even the Caribbean. They're probably anti-Caribbean.
Well, they were. They were very anti-Haitian at one time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
When there was a wave of Haitians that came.
Yeah, I think most people identify in the country. Most people identify, you know, immigration to be a Latino issue because that's all that they see on TV. But it's not.
No.
But it doesn't
not.
Get the same type of press time for other groups that are also struggling with immigration issues. But certainly that's something that doesn't get highlighted.
Well, the part, you know, I talked briefly about one of my son's best friends. He came from an Asian country mm-hmm. and his family lived quite comfortably, undocumented, no concerns about being caught. But unfortunately, when it came time for him to apply for grants, he couldn't get one.
Yeah.
But one nice piece of news came out last week when it was announced that there are more Latinos in California, at least, than there are Caucasians. Yeah. Now, an issue there is getting more Latinos to register to vote and go vote.
Yeah, and that I think you have a lot of the youth. I can say that I know a lot of 20-somethings that are citizens and are registered and maybe voted once, and then they stopped. And I'm not sure why. I think it's a lot of either they don't see the change that they would hope, and right. so they get jaded and they don't want to return because they think it's going to be the same thing. You just make promises, but there's nothing that happens.
And I'm sure it didn't help that President Obama deported more people than any other president ever. I'm sure that...
Oh yeah,
factored in
certainly.
To some of these young people becoming jaded.
But I must say, you know, Sharon and I travel in activist circles in L.A. and have for some years here, and we run into a lot of people like you, young Latinos and Latinas who are very involved in politics, who are very involved in laying the fight for 15 effort, and that's very encouraging, because I think young people in general don't get into the swing of voting.
Yeah, you know, and when you were talking about education and how costly it is, I can definitely identify. Most of the youth that's fighting for, you know, anything with social justice issues, you know, they do listen, they pay attention, and they have their ear to the ground to see who's going to help them out when a lot of these issues come to bat, like education and student loans,
right.
Which, you know, is I was reading something which I guess kind of to go off topic was that it's a big business, and there's a lot of students right now around my age that are suffering from default or, you know, having a hard time paying their student loans. Which is a real issue.
Right, and an issue if Bernie Sanders has anything to do with it, an issue that would be a non-issue in the future. So let's talk a little bit about AB 60, because our hour is quickly coming to an end.
Sure.
We've talked about DACA and DAPA. Let's talk to the audience about AB 60.
So AB 60 is a California law that was implemented starting January 1st of this year, and we really in October of last year, as far as in our ACLU chapter, we helped put together a forum that had in Pasadena about 200 people show up from the local community, really interested to learn what do they need to apply, what requirements are necessary, what type of documentation they need to take in order for them to take the written test.
We're talking about driver's license.
And driver's license, yes. Yes.
So AB 60 would enable people who are
undocumented
to drive lawfully within the state of California?
Yes, as long as they are able to pass the written exam and also the driving test. You know, they will have a driver's license and be able to operate a vehicle lawfully.
One of the benefits of that is that would enable them to be able to get car insurance.
Yes. Yeah, and that would be beneficial not only for them but also for every Californian driving in the state, or really anyone driving in the state, because that would mean that if you get into a car accident, you know, you would have someone else that would have insurance that would hopefully be responsible for any of those types of damages.
Mm-hmm. So this event was a big hit. It was a surprisingly big hit. You didn't expect 200 people.
No, we didn't.
I know the ACLU downtown was thrilled that really a small group of volunteers, you at the lead, got all these people in the room, gave this event in Spanish, had the Mexican consulate there, had CHIRLA, had ACLU, and all these people who needed instructions on how to go about taking advantage of this law that doesn't come with instructions.
Yeah, and certainly, I mean, at that point, we still didn't know a lot of what was going to happen. And now that it's been implemented and that people have been applying, we've had about over 300 people get licenses since it being implemented, and
over 300,000.
Yes, 300,000. Sorry, yeah, 300,000.
You had 300 in the gym,
right? but during that time, you know, there have been a lot of issues about access and languages and what type of documents, and certainly for certain African countries and Asian countries, accessibility of certain type of documents that the DMV says are good for the application process, you know, they're not accepting, or, you know, they're having some issues as to, well, what can they bring in as proof that they're California residents?
I see. So there was a requirement that when they applied to get these driver's license, that they bring in with them certain documentation,
yes,
from the origin, the country of
their
origin.
Their place of origin, yeah. And also to demonstrate that they've lived here in California. So, you know, there are various requirements, and there have been other issues about languages and what...
Languages that the tests are given in.
Yes, that the tests are given in, and translation services. But all of that has been getting worked out, and you know, there have been issues about people getting sent to secondary review, which means that during their application process they get flagged for whatever reason. Their social security maybe doesn't match with a name or other similar issues, and so in that secondary review, a lot of people were applying and would get scared, like, well, what is this? And you know, certainly if you have concerns about you know, you have some sort of misdemeanor, or you have had any kind of run-in with the police, you might need to get legal advice mm-hmm. before pursuing this driver's license.
Right, because they were scared that the DMV or the government or ICE would use this procedure to identify people and deport them.
And certainly the DMV, you know, cooperates with ICE. If ICE is already looking for you, they certainly can go to the DMV.
Right.
And if you've applied, they'll have your address.
Right.
So then it sounds like... similar to DAPA and DACA, AB 60 provides another opportunity for people who are nervous about being deported. It helps to identify them.
And I would say that it helps identify a group of people, those who either have orders to be removed. Also, anyone who ICE is already looking for whatever reason, they do have access to that. Whether they'll use it, but we have heard that it's happened before, mm-hmm. and people get deported.
So one last little comment. I we've worked together on ACLU, and you've talked about starting an ACLU chapter in East LA. What's the point of that?
Well, you know, in the community that I've grown up in, most of my life in East LA and in Boyle Heights, you know, you see the need for a civil rights group, not only the ones that already exist there, but also those like the ACLU that advocate on legal issues of First Amendment rights, civil liberties, to certainly come into the community and provide some of that education on what your rights are as far as in your interactions with police. There has been a lot of violence lately in certain communities against women, but you know, now you have an ability to really bring in a different group into this area, and I think that if we bring it into East LA, I think we'll have a lot of interesting programs for the community that'll benefit them.
You know, there are lots of people who believe that if someone is here in the United States without documentation, that somehow renders them rightless. They have no rights. But according to the ACLU, that's absolutely not true. Are there Know Your Rights programs that the ACLU conducts?
Yes, they do. You know, we as a chapter have only done one that's really catered to parents that were monolingual Spanish speakers. And we provided them some information. But we, you know, we're certainly happy to go out and provide these type of workshops. And I know that the ACLU staff does this. They go out to the community and they provide these workshops.
So I would say anybody who's watching who who would be interested in supporting your work in East LA or Boyle Heights could contact us through LA Progressive, and we would get the information to you.
Yeah. And if people want more information about the ACLU, they should go to aclusocal.org and just do a search for Know Your Rights. Well, I'm hearing the music, so that means that this hour is up already.
Yeah.
Can't believe it.
Yeah.
Golly, Joanna, you talk so much.
Yeah, thank you so much for coming. I think you gave people a real, real sense of what's going on in this arena.
Well, absolutely, and you know, people are really fortunate that there are people like you working as a champion for this much, much needed this cause that we really can't say enough. A lot of people don't even realize that when someone is detained for immigration, they're not entitled to an attorney. You know, the state doesn't provide an attorney unless they have the money. Yeah. Lots of people don't know. People are just detained indefinitely.
Yes.
And no legal representation.
That's unfortunate, but true.
Unfortunate. Well, this is LA Progressive. We find ourselves at the end of another hour that seemed to fly by in less than 5 minutes. This is your host, Sharon Kyle. We interview Joanna Amador, and my co-host, Dick Price, and I will be back next week, same time, same place. This is LA Progressive Live, streaming to you from LATalkLive.com. And we'd like to thank Richard Carr, as usual, for being such a great program engineer. We'll see you next week, same time, same place. So long.
Thank you, sugar.
Is
it near or is it far? Is it distant like a star? What color is love? Does it glow like an ember? And do you remember if love doesn't last? Does it live in the past? And a heart cannot live if a heart isn't giving. When it's over, does it show? Does it leave an afterglow? And what color is...
Thank you for tuning into LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network. Original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.